So there are three basic ways, three basic principles through which we gain, we attain self-awareness. First, it's self-observation. So we learn to observe our body, our thoughts and our emotions, and how these three interact. We do this in an objective way, without judging or interfering. Imagine that it's like having a camera on top of your head. And this camera records, yes, like yours. And this camera records our body posture, records how we feel, what we think, and how these three interact. Steadily as we exercise more and more self-conservation. And we become more and more conscious in the here and now. And this is what gives us the possibility to change, to make any changes, because we know who we are, how we feel, what we think, and since we know it, we live in the here and now, we can change this if we like, of course. And it reveals not only our unconscious functions, but also the strength and the power that lies in us, and sometimes we don't even imagine that there is, that it is there. So self-observation is not a mere mental exercise that we do on our own, but we discuss our observations with the leaders of the same study groups, we will tell you about the same study groups later on. So we discuss our observations with the leaders of the groups, and they support us through this process so that we see all these aspects that are revealed as manifestations of the one self. And we address whatever comes to the spiritual field, all these observations to the spiritual field, meaning not only this specific person, but this person's spiritual stance, that everything is of spiritual nature. So it's not just a matter of knowing, it's a matter of knowing in depth, of accepting, of viewing all aspects as manifestations of the whole, and addressing it back to the whole, that is what liberates us. The second principle is creating meditation. So as we said earlier, you learned some Greek. So the Greek word for meditation is dialogismos. It comes from the word dialogos, that is dialogue. So there's a dialogue with the inner self that takes place in us constantly. A dialogue with other people, with things, with our body, with our emotions, with our thoughts, with the whole environment. Every meditation, we consciously participate in this dialogue. We become more and more aware of it. So this dialogue starts itself becoming more broad and revealing. It's a constant union that takes place in meditation, a union of the opposites. It's the opposite aspects in ourselves. It's the union and balancing of the opposite energies that permeate us. It's the forces that restrain us with the forces that liberate us. And ultimately, it's the union of our confined ego with the powers of the psyche so that our ontological self can emerge. It's then that we experience the pulsation, we experience the harmony, the flow of life, we experience the union of the whole universe. That is what some people call a peak experience. But according to the society's teaching, meditation is not an act of introversion. It's not an act of being on our own, being so it has to do with everyday life. It's not about seeking rare moments of happiness or rare moments of fulfillment. Because this would make us distant from everybody else. And we don't believe that. We believe that we are everybody else, so this cannot happen. So our everyday life is both the focus and the aim of meditation. And what is revealed through meditation is that life is not static. It's not a static thing, but all the revelations can be put in practice in our everyday life, so we become creative participants. That is why it's called creative meditation, because it teaches us how to become creative participants in our lives. We are the creators of our own lives. And the third principle is service. So according to the above, service comes naturally, it's a simple action. Comes naturally through self-observation and meditation, because we learn that we and the others are one, we experience this union, we learn that our spiritual, that our nature is actually the spiritual one. So we come to realize that serving the others, serving the whole planet, and serving us ourselves is exactly the same thing. It's one and the same. So we externalize the energies and powers of the psyche to express our ontological self through showing sincere, total, and selfless interest to the others. We ask nothing in return, not even recognition for what we offer. We don't want anything. So this way we come out of the boundaries of ourself and we become united to the others.
Yes. That's the question. Yes. You're using the word psyche.
Psyche.
Yes. Yeah. And that's a Greek word, isn't it?
Yes.
But it means, so some people just the mind and some people the soul. I wonder how you're using it.
It's, let's say, it's all the energies and the powers in the body. One definition.
Is it a personal?
One definition is all the energies and the powers in the body. But there's also another definition we could give, and it has to do with it's the individual,
the part of the
yes, the individual part of the whole self.
Yeah.
So it's one self. You know, my soul is one, the piece of this self that has been in my body, it expresses itself through my body and personality.
Well, I understand it, yes.